Hey, kids, you're listening to A Couple of Annoyed Grunt Boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons Podcast. That was Here Comes Your Man by the Pixies. Later in the hour, we're going to have songs from Foreigner, Asia, and a rock block of sticks. But first, we're going to talk cartoons. That's right. This is the podcast that discusses the beloved animated sitcom, The Simpsons, from seasons 11 and beyond. Why 11 and beyond, you ask? Well, an entity known as the Wheel of Random cursed us to only review episodes from those seasons and the new episodes when they air. And why were we cursed? Well, you see, there's plenty of other podcasts out there that discuss the golden age of The Simpsons, that of course being seasons 1 through 10. So the wheel appointed us on this quest. And when I say us, I can't do this alone. You see, I'm Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig, and with me is...
Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve. Hi, Craig.
Hey, Steve. This is going to be the last time I talk to you for a couple weeks.
Was it something I said?
Yeah. You said, Craig, you need a vacation. And I said, okay, thank you.
Oh, yeah, I do remember saying that. And you do need a vacation.
Yeah, I'm going out of town. I'm going to California.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Probably by this time that people hear the episode, I might be in Universal Studios hanging out at Moe's or the Krusty Burger or the Quickie Mart.
Oh, boy, that's a lot of fun.
Do they have those still at the Universal Studios?
They do, and you can get some fried chicken from Cletus's Chicken Shack.
Although they probably don't pay much attention to the Simpsons property on the park because it's now owned by Disney, so like, fuck that.
That is true, yeah.
Do you think they're going to move the Simpsons universe to like Disney California Adventure?
I mean, it would be convenient on one hand, but also it kind of gives you a real reason to go to Universal Studios.
I'm going to do that. And, you know, there's like the Jurassic World ride.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
The Mummy Returns, which you recommended to me. I'll do that ride. And then is Bruce, a.k.a. Jaw, still there?
I do believe he is. Yeah, you do get to see him on the tour.
I want to see the clock tower from Back to the Future.
Maybe not.
No, that's still there, isn't that? That whole town scene, or that whole town square, it has to still be there because I still see
that's true.
TV show film there. I'm like, oh, that's just the Universal backlot for the town center.
Yeah, it's that's Gilmore Girls.
Yeah, it's fun watching like Gremlins and like, hey, that's the same center as in Back to the Future. Yeah.
Yeah.
E.T.'s gone though, right?
E.T. is gone.
The Back to the Future ride. I think what you're thinking is the Back to the Future ride.
That's what I'm thinking of, because I think it was replaced by The Simpsons.
So that's gone. But Disney, I'm going to go to Disney. I'm going to, do I go to the Star Wars land to make my own lightsaber, or I'll make my own droid? I don't know.
Oh, man.
What do I want to spend $200 on plastic for?
That's what every nerd should ask themselves at one point in their life.
As I'm surrounded by toys on the wall. Yeah. Do I need a customizable lightsaber? Which I have access to a 3D printer and I could probably make my own, right?
Yeah, that's true.
But a remote control droid sounds fun, but only for like a couple minutes.
Yeah.
I think when I'm at Disneyland, I think one of the great things that you could do now that I couldn't do when I was six was go to like the New Orleans Square, because I think, you know, it's been a few years. I think now you can buy booze, right?
I think so, yeah.
I'd be happy to buy a $30 Lime Mickey. It's like a Lime Ricky, but Lime Mickey, right?
Right, yeah. A Donald Dunkel.
Yeah. Ooh, a Donald Dunkel. That's like a beer, right?
Yeah.
Which reminds me. Let's go to one of our favorite segments, the Simpsons Beer Corner. All right, Steve. Well, I might be spiritually in Disneyland while everyone's listening to this podcast. I'm here with you to watch The Simpsons. So what are you going to be drinking while we watch The Simpsons this week?
Well, Craig, this episode features music by The Pixies. And The Pixies make me think of Pixie Sticks, which makes me think of candy. And, you know, This episode also features some tiny round candies that have N and N's on them, which made me think about other candies that have or that are round and small and have letters on them. And so I have from Prairie Brewing a candy called Tiny S's, not Tiny Asses, Tiny S's. And it is a beer, a sour beer with orange peel, lemon peel, lime, candy, certified colors, titanium dioxide, and FDNC yellow number 5. It comes in at 5.9%. And the reason it's called Tiny S's is because this beer is supposed to emulate Skittles. The can is fairly kid-friendly. It's purple with a drawing of a microscope. And on the microscope sights, there are the Tiny S's that we all drew in middle school. 6 bars, and then you connect them. You know what I'm talking about.
Well, that's called a Stussy logo, isn't it?
It is, but there's some controversy that Stussy didn't actually invent it and that people were drawing it before them. But yes, I always refer to it as a Stussy S.
Is Stussy still a thing?
I always feel like it's for jerks and douchebags, but I could be wrong.
It's probably sadly like a Marshall's clothing brand.
Yeah, you might be right. Kind of like how Mossimo was like a cool brand until Target bought it.
Yeah. He was like, Target was like, hey, we're giving you all this money. He's like, oh, I could pay UCLA to get my daughter into college. Awesome.
Good pull. Hey, there's Aunt Becky.
Have mercy.
So this beer is 5.9%. It's from Prairie Artisan Ales from Oklahoma.
From what ales?
Prairie.
From what was the name? What was the kind of brand?
Oh,
or
sorry. Artisanal.
Thank you.
Ales. Yeah. So it is a vibrant orange color, and it even has a piece of candy floating in it.
What? Like in the can?
Yeah.
Is it like the equivalent of like the tequila with the worm?
Kind of. It's like a white ball that I think used to be. I really think that they're trying to avoid lawsuits, but I think it is an actual Skittle that they put into the beer, into each can, because it's like white, but it, because it, I think it, the rest of the sugary beer eroded it. Oh, man.
This makes me nervous. Have you opened it and tried it?
I'm smelling it, and it smells like the person sitting next to you is chewing on a bunch of Skittles.
Okay.
Oh my god,
is it,
it tastes like Skittles,
like no hint of booze, or
it's not a beer. It tastes like, I mean, it's 5.9%, but
was this a sour? I'm sorry.
Yeah, it is, but it's not sour. It literally just tastes like Skittles. It's incredible.
That's like,
I don't know that I could drink. It might be tough for me to finish this because it's very sweet, but it's just like opening a bag of Skittles and chowing down on mostly the citrus flavors.
That's like, I'll do the equivalent to our stoner friends here. Ooh. Like when you get in, like, remember when edibles first started coming out, like to buy legally, mm-hmm. you still got the hint of like weed, but now like edibles, when you taste them, like, no, I'm eating a chocolate that actually tastes really good. Like I want to eat this chocolate more. This is better than like a Hershey's chocolate. I don't taste the weed at all. And then 2 hours later, like, oh fuck, there is weed in this.
Right. That's exactly what this is.
Wow.
Yeah. I highly recommend. I'm coming. Me too, Marge. Anybody who can get their hands on this, to at least get a can, because it's an experience and it's great.
All right. Send it to me in California.
All right.
I'm going to share it with Goofy.
Gosh, that's a good beer.
All right. Well, I am excited to actually try your beer.
Good. What have you got for us, Craig?
Steve, last week I alluded to a beer that I had purchased about a cinnamon French toast porter.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, you know, breakfasty, of course. But in this episode, there was a connection. Bart, Lisa, and Milhouse go to get breakfast.
Oh, yeah.
And you get French toast at breakfast. So I'm going with Embers Cinnamon French Toast Porter from Payette Brewing out of Boise, Idaho.
Oh.
Idaho.
Ida Pimp.
Their address is 733 South Pioneer Street, Boise, Idaho, 83702. Mail them that the Annoying Grunt Boys sent you. I don't know what you're sending to them, but it'll be fun. Kind of kid-friendly can. It's got like a bunny, but he's dressed in a tux with a little serving tray with a lid on it. So maybe, no, it's an adult bunny, but like not a cartoon bunny. So it's kind of funny because there's,
yeah,
you know, like you see like the rodents or like squirrels or bunnies with like their mouth is always a droop because they always look sad.
Yeah.
It's like that.
Yeah. Very stern bunny looking.
Yeah. Yeah. This bunny's so stern, I'm going to call him Howard.
Bunny Bowie.
All right. It comes in at a fun 6% alcohol. Mm-hmm. Payette Brewing Company Embers Cinnamon French Toast. It tastes like brunch. Giddy up. Cinnamon, maple syrup, and vanilla wrap this dark porter in roasted comfort without being overly sweet. It is like a warm hug on a cozy Sunday morning. I feel like that last like copy line is just like, yeah, I think it's something cliche.
Yeah.
I mean, a slice of apple pie without a cheese is a wiener without a squeeze. Is that how that goes?
Yeah, that's exactly how that goes.
I get hints of porter. You know, it's that wheat Chex type of smell.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I should try it with my tongue.
It sounds very good, by the way. Yeah. The beer itself.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Did you get that hint of cinnamon?
Ooh, nice.
You know, you get the Cinnabon-y flavor. Think of it this way. You know, you make Rice Krispie treats with Rice Krispie and marshmallows. And mm-hmm. then, you know, 20 years ago, people were like, you know, you could also make Rice Krispie treats with other cereal flavors. And so you do that with like Cinnamon Toast Crunch. This is kind of what that kind of resembles.
Okay.
Like biting into Cinnamon Toast Crunch, but not overly super sweet. And it's true with the dark porter, when it says about not overly sweet. This is delightful, actually. This is probably one of the better dessert beers.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, a lot of times with dessert beers, if they're overly, like with your current beer, is overly sweet. Like you say, you can only do one, maybe, right? Is it going to be hard? Is it going to be hard to finish that beer?
No, because it's so tasty. But I could see how somebody would be a little off put by it.
I should have drank this for our morning podcast. It would have been for last week, because it would have probably been a shorter podcast.
Yeah, that's possible.
Yeah, I think if you guys can find this, and if you're into cinnamon for me is one of my favorite flavor profiles of all time.
So good.
This is something I would like to have in my fridge or on the presence of my property, surrounded by, of course, the moats and the alligators and crocodiles and the machine guns that I have pointed to the outside of it. This is an amazing beer.
Sounds incredible. I'm glad that it wasn't so sweet, because that would be my biggest concern.
I think there's been times when I've had like cinnamon flavored type beer, and I think this one is one of the better ones. Idaho, you've got potatoes, and now you've got a great beer.
Nice.
We are sober men and true and attentive to our duty.
All right, Steve. So let's get into the mindset of this week's episode, which originally aired February 17th in the year of 2013. Ooh. Steve, what was the number one movie in the box office?
Well, Craig, the number one movie was a sequel to an okay movie. That was a sequel to a great movie. That was a sequel to a remake of the same movie. That was a sequel to everyone's favorite Christmas movie. That's right. The number one movie in the box office on February 17th, 2013 was A Good Day to Die Hard.
That was like the Valentine's Day weekend was.
Yeah.
Hey, babe, I'm going to take you to the fifth Die Hard movie.
Oh, boy.
That was the fifth one. Yeah. I never saw that one. I heard it was really bad.
Yeah. I remember that we saw the fourth one in
like
the theater
10 years previous.
Yeah. After going to the worst bar in Portland.
That was a lot of fun, though.
It was a lot of fun. And while the fourth one wasn't great, it was a good time.
Steve, I'll let you know, I haven't seen the fourth Die Hard movie since we had our date that day.
I do believe I'm in the same boat.
2008 or 9, maybe? 7? One of those years.
Yeah, maybe 8 or 9, probably.
Good memories. Yeah, I still haven't seen this good. I just know that this Die Hard movie is supposed to be bad. It's got Jacques Courtney in it, I think, is Bruce Willis's kid, and they're in Russia.
Okay.
That's all I know from it. I mean, eventually on our Patreon, where we will cover all of the Die Hard movies.
Mm-hmm. We'll do it in December.
Right. And we'll also pitch the original movie that was supposed to star Frank Sinatra as his character.
Yeah. Still and then, very funny to me.
And then because the movies started on the 80s, we'll also pitch the animated series that a lot of movies for some reason in the 80s had animated series for, like Police Academy or Rambo or Karate Kid.
Yeah.
We're going to do the Die Hard kids cartoon series pitch.
I love it.
It'll be like John McClane, Die Hard, of course, character. And then like he's going to have like a talking animal with him.
Right. It's a horse named Mother Flipper. He hops on it and he's like, yippee-ki-yay, Mother Flipper.
So, oh, and of course, don't forget Ghostbusters had the real Ghostbusters, which of course I love because Ghostbusters is my favorite. But like, here's my pitch for the Die Hard. So it's after the first movie. The sequels don't exist yet, but it'll be him. And then Carlo Winslow, what's his name?
Reginald Bell Johnson.
Yeah, he'll play his cop buddy.
Mm-hmm.
And then do you also get the limo driver maybe in it too?
Yeah, I think so.
Maybe they go to him for missions for some reason. Like,
or right,
like
he's the boss. I heard,
not the boss, but like he's like a Huggy Bear type character. Like,
okay, starts to
yeah. But then they go around the country solving crimes. Die Hard style.
I like it.
And then, yeah, every episode is him going to be saying yippee-ki-yay, like, but like not motherfucker. It'll be like a cute way because Carl Wentz will be like, don't say it.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we already pitched that, so that's great.
I like it.
A Good Day to Die Hard sucks, apparently, to everyone, but one of these days we'll watch it.
All right, Craig. Well, we were all not watching A Good Day to Die Hard, but when we were driving around in our cars, what were we rocking out to?
Well, Steve, I was probably heading over to like Goodwill.
Oh.
Because I was trying to find some secondhand items at a thrift shop from Macklemore and Ryan Lewis. I'm gonna pop some tags. Only got $20 in my pocket. I'm looking for a cover. Awesome. Yeah, we all know thrift shop.
Yeah,
it's there.
Yeah, it's funny. I haven't heard it in probably like, you know, since it came out, and it was like legitimately considered like a serious pop song. I know it's kind of silly in tone, but it's like basically just a poorly written Weird Al song.
Reviewing this song called Thrift Shop by Macklemore, I'll say, especially now, like I feel like this song is like overplayed in movies and TVs.
Yeah, for sure.
All right. Well, there's the song. We reviewed it and it's a parody. So don't take this episode off the air, Spotify.
We gave critical thought to this song.
Yeah. It's very vaudevillian. To say something alien, and you know, we'll be fine.
Yeah, it's Machiavellian. It's Macklemorevian.
It's a little too raff.
It truly is a little too rough.
All right, Steve, let's just get on with this week's episode, which of course is titled Hardly Kirk-Ing. In this episode, we get Bart and Milhouse explore the perks of adulthood following a shaving experiment.
Ooh.
Marge tries to save Maggie from the dangers of TV, and Homer tries to find images in highlights, and Lisa spoils everything.
She always does.
All right, Steve. Let's continue our beers and then I come back and just really talk about this episode. How about that?
Sounds great.
All right, we'll be right back. That's a cold ass honky. Rolling in hella deep, headed to the mezzanine, dressed in all pinks and my gator shoes. Those are and we're back. This week we're talking about Hardly Kirk-Ing, the 13th episode of the 24th season, originally aired February 17th, 2013. It is episode 521 in the show's run. Your nerd code is RABF05. It was written by Tom Gammill and Max Pross, directed by Matthew Nastuk, and your showrunner is Al Jean. Am I saying that right? Tom Gammill and Max Pross, or is it Pross?
I believe it's Pross, Gammill and Pross. And this is the first episode from them that we've reviewed, and they were nominated for a WGA Writer Guild of America for this episode, so hopefully it's a good one.
They sound like lawyers, Gammill and Pross.
Where's Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe? They've written other episodes for other successful shows, such as several episodes of Seinfeld, including The Raincoats, The Race, The Glasses, The Cigar Store Indian, which probably doesn't hold up to modern day stuff.
Yeah, because we don't smoke cigars anymore.
Exactly. It's horrible for you.
It should be The Vape Store Indian.
Exactly. Although, if we were communicating via smoke signals, that would be a lot more effective because those vape kids, you know, they get fat clouds. The Critic, they also wrote an episode of The Critic, and then they've worked on The Simpsons as producers since 1999. They won an Emmy for Homer, H-O-M-R, the one with the crayon up the nose. They wrote this episode. Then they wrote Monty Burns Fleeing Circus from season 28. And they wrote Whistler's Father, The Old Blue Mare, She Ain't What She Used to Be, and three scenes plus a tag from A Marriage for season 29. And then in 31, they wrote season 31, they wrote The Incredible Lightness of Being a Baby.
Well, I remember the episode Homer, H-O-M-R. We have yet to review that, right?
That's one that I'm kind of looking forward to because I remember it very fondly, but I haven't seen it in years.
And it's also like a canon episode where like you see sometimes maybe in future episodes, the crayon still in Homer's skull.
Yeah.
It's an absurd idea, but I remember it fondly as well.
Yeah.
I mean, they've been around during the SNL days, Steve, the OGs, SNLs.
Yeah, that's right.
They know who Dan Aykroyd is and Steve Martin.
Not only that, but in Ghostbusters 2.
My favorite sequel to Ghostbusters 1.
There you go. Take that, answer the call. Gammill and Pross, there's a Gammill and Pross infant acuity test. So they're referenced in the movie.
Wow.
So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and as being a huge ghost head, I didn't know that. So now I know.
AKA that's, Onion Head.
Yeah, that's the scene where Dana Barrett, played by Sigourney Weaver, talks to Egon, played by Harold Ramis. He's testing on kids, I think. That's probably the scene. Okay, cool.
Yeah, I think so.
Wow. All right. Well, I'm excited for these guys. I know the episode Homer is the only one I can really remember, but some absurd things happen in that and some absurd things happen in this. So
that's true. Yeah. So they're absurd guys, those Hamill and Pross. They were also uncredited writers on Son of the Mask, the Raspberry Award winning film from 2005, and the sequel to the 1994 hit film by Jim Carrey, The Mask.
I remember those, like, we need to make sequels to Jim Carrey movies. And he's like, I don't want to make sequels, so don't, like, I'm not going to be part of it. Like, there's the Son of Mask. They did the Dumb and Dumber origin story.
And what is it? Ace Ventura Jr.? Is that what they call it?
Ace Ventura. Yeah. Kid Pet Detective, maybe?
Yeah. I think so. Yeah. It's just a lot of pressure to put on a kid. Be as funny as Jim Carrey.
That's what I say to you every day before we hit record.
Somebody stop me. Really, I'm not good.
Yeah. All right. Should we start the episode right now?
No.
All right. I'll be back.
We got some more stuff. So the first time this episode aired in the U.S., it was shortened to show the short Maggie Simpson in The Longest Daycare. So there was no chalkboard gag, no couch gag. And well, there was a couch gag, but it was very short, which we'll get to in a moment. But also that made the episode 19 and a half minutes, which is the shortest Simpsons episode ever. And also the only episode to run under 20 minutes. So we should get through this in a breeze because it's a very short episode.
Especially since last week's episode was
the longest episode ever.
And we apologize.
And you're welcome.
But mostly, we're sorry.
Yeah, we're sorry. And so The Longest Daycare, of course, the kind of like what started this whole Simpsons short phenomenon.
I'm just making this podcast longer.
The Longest Daycare was the television debut, but it originally aired on July 13th, 2012, with the premiere with Ice Age Continental Drift.
That also could be a title for a Fast and Furious movie.
That's what I was thinking. Like, I know that they had talked about doing, I think, a Men in Black crossover.
With
Fast and Furious.
I knew about the 21 Jump Street.
Yeah.
And Men in Black with, you know, 21 Jump Street with Channing Tatum and Jonah Hill.
Right. But what if the Fast and Furious folks drove so fast they went back in time?
They're owned by Universal, right? Is that okay? Yeah. I mean, at this point, you know, the Marvel universe, the MCU is so big, I would go see that. You know,
yeah.
Isn't E.T. also part of Universal?
Oh, yeah.
E.T., Jaws, you know, a lot of the earlier Spielberg stuff.
Yeah.
Back to the Future, so they could have the DeLorean time machine.
Ooh, yeah. How you get it. That's like, it's mostly about the Fast and Furious characters, but that's how you get there.
Right.
Is they somehow heist the DeLorean.
And they time travel through like eras of Universal movies. So like you could bring back Brendan Fraser's The Mummy.
Oh, yeah.
All the Universal monsters that they want to do. They can make a fun joke with the Tom Cruise, like restarting the Marvel or the Monster Universe. Like, not this guy. I don't know. Isn't where they tried to do the whole Monster Universe with Tom Cruise. Didn't work.
Did not work.
With his mummy. Not his mom, but his.
Right.
Are his parents. Does he even have parents?
No, I don't think so. I think he was born in a tube.
Torpedo tube from an airplane.
Exactly.
Pew pew. All right. The Longest Daycare. Wow. And now we get what? A couple shorts on Disney Plus a year about, so, right?
Yeah, there's a new one forthcoming soon.
Do we know what it's about?
I don't remember.
I'm assuming Maggie.
Probably.
It'll be like a tongue-in-cheek thing, probably with like Maggie subscribes to Disney Plus, and so should you. Here's all the great things. And it's just, you know, a 2-minute commercial for Disney and how great they are.
Yeah, or it's a music video where she meets Megan Thee Stallion and
Lizzo.
She has a wet-ass pacifier.
Jesus. All right. Well, can we now start the episode?
You're allowed, Craig. Go right ahead.
All right. Well, this is what appears on the Disney Plus version, because like you said, it aired, you know, with just a couch gag. But there was a billboard and chalkboard, I guess, because what we saw on Disney Plus was a title gag of Springfield's favorite daredevil, Lance Murdoch. No, not Not Matt Murdock. He's not Springfield's favorite Daredevil, Steve.
Oh.
Yeah, he's jumping through the Aaron's motor bike. We also get a Dr. Nick's Valentine Hart's Human Cow of Mystery billboard gag, and then a chalkboard gag of I Will Not Tweet as the principal's toilet. Now, I like to come up with theories now, chalkboard gags, and here's what I believe it was.
Okay.
He took Skinner's phone and started tweeting from Skinner's phone and then saying he was the principal's toilet, and Krabappel thought it was fucking hilarious and didn't punish him. But Skinner was pissed at Krabappel. Was like, you need to punish him for doing that. And she's like, fine, I will. She didn't want to. Skinner made her do it. Yeah, because at this point in time, they're not together. She's with Flanders.
Right.
So there we go.
That makes a lot of sense.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
I like that. Then we get a couch gag, and I'm not going to go through all of it, but it's a spoof of the Game of Thrones opening, and it's a very faithful thing with all the things popping up, much like we saw for the first time in 2 weeks or 2 weeks ago on the House of Dragon, and they have a new full opening, which is a lot of fun. This one was first seen in Exit Through the Quickie Mart from season 23, and so in the original broadcast version, the couch gag was just the soldier coming in and chopping off Homer's head and a little bit of Marge's hair. But here you go through a whole phase and you go through all of Springfield and landing on the couch. There's a lot of three-eyed ravens.
Finally, you get your three-eyed ravens.
That's right.
So this must have been then to fill the time because of the... It's all. I don't know how this was like planned out, because you said this was from season 23, but they never showed the full intro in 23.
Yeah.
They went and animated this new intro to fit that. So I'm wondering if was those the chalkboard and then the billboard, was that actually from that same episode? I didn't do that much of that research, but I'm asking you if you did.
I believe that they're all reused. And so initially there was not any of this. So this is all reused, rehashed stuff.
Okay. Yeah. So eventually when we get to that episode, we'll have recognized it.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. I'm glad we sorted that out. Yeah, the Game of Thrones. Steve, did you finally watch House of Spies? Dragon Spies. What's it called? House of Pancakes?
House of Pancakes, yeah. Waffle House, the dragon story. Yes, I did. And it feels like Game of Thrones.
Yeah. I feel it's like it's more of like a toned down version. Like, you know, you got to see Game of Thrones and you saw all these different houses and different environments. But now you're just like stuck in King's Landing with the Targaryens, and that's it.
Yeah.
But one thing that kind of like the first episode of Game of Thrones was great because you met everybody, you're setting the scene, and then it ends on a great cliffhanger when you realize that Jaime Lannister and what was her name? Cersei? Is that her name? Cersei Lannister? Or
yeah.
The two brother and sister.
I think so.
You see them that they're brother and sister, and like, holy shit, they're incestual because they're banging each other. And then they push little Bran Stark out of the window. Like, holy fuck, what's going on here? But for the first episode of House of Dragon, you're just like, you understand each character. You're like, I already know that guy's bad. I already know that lady's bad. I know all these people. I know these characters. And right, like, it just ends with like, it ends on like a, and here's what you've been waiting for, the theme song. Like, cool. It's like a superhero movie, but like, and then you get the second episode and I'm not gonna spoil it, but the second episode, the twist ending, you're like, no, we saw this coming. So there hasn't been any like twist surprises, like with the characters, like you just understand everyone's intention. And also,
yeah, which is
the main girl that we're following, the one that looks like she's 12, but she's actually 23. Cause I had to look this up. Cause I was like, wait, is she like 12?
Thank you. Weird. It was confusing me the whole time. It was like, this girl could be 9 or 35.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay, well, she's just Bean from Disenchantment. This is just a live action of Disenchantment. Simpsons or Groening did it. I'm just waiting for her to run away and find Elfo and Lucy.
Yeah.
But I'll probably still end up watching this whole series before I finish Disenchantment.
Yeah, sounds about right.
But if they ever do a live action Disenchantment, cast her because she looks just like Bean.
Definitely. We'll do that next week.
How about Eric Andre as Lucy?
I like that Matt Faxon, and I'll use him again. Okay. He can be Elfo.
All right. Well, John DiMaggio is the dad.
Yeah, and you know that League of Their Own series on Amazon is very popular. Why don't we get somebody from that to play Bean? Let's say, yeah, Abby Jacobson, maybe.
All right. Well, let's get to the episode actually beginning. And it begins, as it always does, Steve, with the drawing of a pink circle. And then wavy orange lines are drawn on each side of the circle with a triangle appearing on the top. Why, it appears that these shapes are taking the form of a circus clown. First, I thought it was going to be Krusty, but it's not.
Nope.
Steve, what are we watching?
I don't know. Let's find out.
Dad, what are you watching?
I think it's a Terrence Malick movie.
No, you're watching Baby Poindexter, the most educational DVD available at the checkout aisle at the grocery store.
Finally, a kid show that isn't trying to sell you something. Which reminds me, we need to order more rectangles.
The Terrence Malick joke is good. Like,
yeah.
And then Homer, of course, need more rectangles.
Yeah, we're off to a good start. Yeah, I remember trying to watch, what is it, Melancholia? Is that that's a Terrence Malick film, I think.
I don't know.
And it's just very confusing. Like, a lot of stuff happens, but I don't know what. So yeah, that was a funny joke. And obviously they're parodying Baby Einstein videos, which were, for a moment, very popular and all the rage. But then I think they did discover that they weren't good, or they don't do much for helping children with developmental growth. But I don't know.
I have no knowledge of Baby Einstein. Is it Bob Einstein? Was it him?
Yeah, Super Dave Osborne. And his brother, and they're just, he eats a potato funny, and he has a little speak and spell.
Well, I would want to watch that.
I know, it'd be really funny. No, I think they played classical music over, like, calming visual images.
Oh, yeah.
In hopes of sparking artistic creativity, and I don't think there was anything duplicitous about it, but I just think that, you know, parents swore by it, and then they realized it's just a calming thing for anybody. So, yeah.
Well, I'm glad that we weren't raised with a Baby Einstein, Steve. I mean, we just had regular old Albert Einstein.
That's right.
Our parents put up the poster of him sticking his tongue out in hopes that we'll be smart. But it turns out we just love eating ass because we're millennials.
That's right. Yeah, my parents would just show me that movie with Meg Ryan and Walter Matthau, where Matthau plays, and I think Tim Robbins is in it too.
Yeah, IQ.
IQ, yeah.
What's there's like a thing he says, like a funny, like it's in the trailer too. I don't know if it's like huzzah or something like that, but
yeah,
it's a very cute movie. I remember watching it. Like it's one of those, like, is it bad? Is it good? I mean, it's not good.
No, but
you can't turn away. I mean, it's got Walter freaking Matthau in it.
Yeah. It feels like you're like spending the weekend at your aunt's house and she has a few VHS tapes and that's one of them. Yeah. And
then you have you have all like the Tom Hanks, Meg Ryan movies.
Of course.
And that one, you're like, well, I don't want to watch Sleepers in Seattle or
You've Got Mail.
You Got Mail. But she doesn't, and she doesn't have Joe Versus the Volcano. So you're like, all right, fine. IQ it is.
Yeah.
Tim Robbins. That was like right after like Shawshank. And like there was a little renaissance with Robbins.
Yeah.
He was kind of like a little bit of an indie actor at the time and then got Shawshank and he blew up.
Yeah. Where did he go? I haven't seen him. I don't remember the last movie I saw him in.
Oh, no. Do you think he's like an anti-vaxxer?
Oh, no.
Is that why Susan left him?
I think so, yeah.
From Layson and Google here, it says Tim Robbins and Gartella Branca settled divorce. Apparently got married. He finally settled down with someone.
That's good.
Oh, he was in 10 episodes of Castle Rock. It was a short-lived Hulu show. I watched the first season. I never got to the second one. And
sounds like the same happened to him.
And I don't remember him from the first season. I don't think he was in the first season. Maybe he was. I don't know. But yeah, it looks like post-COVID, geez, like he has something coming up, Wool, TV series that he's filming. So there's a TV show. And it's got Rebecca Ferguson and Ian Glenn coming up.
Okay.
It says men and women live in a giant silo underground with a lot of regulations which they think are supposed to protect them from the toxic and ruined world of the surface. Okay.
Interesting.
And you know what? Hey, Tim Robbins is like, he's in his 70s. Why are we getting, like, why does he have to work, dude? Let him relax, Steve. You made me look this up. Right. Tim, I know you're listening. Just enjoy your retirement or a semi-retirement. You don't need to work. You got all that Howard the Duck money.
That's right.
So here we are trying to make fun of tall man Tim Robbins. Anyways, Steve wants to ask you permission to date Susan Sarandon, if that's okay, even though you're not together.
Yes. Can I, please?
Even though he's married, it's fine.
Yeah.
Email at steve@gmail.com.
Yeah. We won't talk about politics because he's a big Bernie bro or whatever. But
who Tim is?
Anyway, back to The Simpsons. Susan Sarandon. So the edutainment video continues with a puppet of a dragon hugging a panda puppet as a voice says, friend. Entranced by this, Maggie crawls towards the television, trying to hug it. The puppet's friends are then introduced to an elephant wearing a fedora, black-framed glasses, and holding a briefcase. The video's voiceover artist refers to the elephant as a colleague, causing all the puppets to dance.
All right, and then Big Hair herself, Marge, steps into the living room, demanding that the video be stopped, saying that it doesn't do any good, and then she holds up a copy of Springfield Shopper, which has the headline, DVD useless, generation ruined. Springfield Shopper must have a lot of stock options in like streaming services, right?
Yeah.
The newspaper also features an ad for baby Poindexter videos claiming to raise babies' IQ while you ignore. Next to the ad is a graph showing baby Poindexter's rapidly declined stocks.
Oh, no.
Which is funny that the Springfield Shopper, like, DVD useless, like, some of our newspapers.
Yeah. Also, like, nothing else happened that day. The front page.
It's also the Springfield Shopper. When I think Shopper, like, anytime there's a publication, it's always, like, the free, when you were kids, there was always, like, that free stand of paper that said free.
Yeah.
And you grab it, and you're like, cool, I got a free newspaper. Where's the comics? Where's the word search? There's none of this in here.
This is like people trying to sell their old tackle box or something.
The penny saver, that's what they were.
That's right.
Do those exist? I don't think they do.
Probably not.
Bummer.
Bummer. That's what they grew into. Craigslist.
My list.
Your list.
Not Angie's list.
That's right. Screw you, Angie. It's Craigslist. Go find a worker or whatever you do. Is that what they do? I don't know.
Yeah. It's yeah. For, they're like, they try to find tasks for those rabbits out there.
I think they're too busy fucking, so they don't want to work. Homer's attention to the TV is transfixed when Marge yells at him. As she lectures him about taking the kids outside, Homer just sees Marge as a collection of shapes. Using his own polygon hands, Homer rearranges Marge's face, turning her frown literally upside down, leaving her in a pleasant, if awkward, pose. Marge then says that the DVD may have stunted the development of the kids who watched it. And it's like Marge's pose. She's all smiley.
Well, because especially like Homer like does that to her. And then when you then pan out to like the real world, she's still doing it. I
think it's hilarious.
So Lisa points out that both she and Bart watched the video series when they were younger. And then she asks why she turned out so, you know, academically superior while Bart. And then before Lisa can finish her thought, Marge jumps in and says that Bart turned out so wonderful in his own way. I always loved when Lisa's always like, you know, point out like the Bart's failures. And Marge is kind of like, you know, tries to put a positive spin on Bart and his.
Yeah.
Like she's in denial that Bart's a dumbass.
Right. He's her special little guy.
And Bart.
We like Bart.
And so she says that Bart knows that tone, and because that's the way people talk about Ralph, whose favorite color is peanut butter.
I don't think that's dumb, to be honest with you. Peanut butter's a good color.
I mean, it's still like diarrhea brown.
Only if you eat a lot of peanut butter.
Yeah. Chunky or creamy.
Hopefully creamy, just because, you know, sick of ease, but yeah, gross. Marge wishes she knew what happened, and we flash back to Bart and Lisa as toddlers, watching rectangles in the shape of a truck riding across the screen. Bart is engrossed, but Lisa's attention is elsewhere. She dumps the DVDs out of their cardboard boxes and folds them into a castle. She then pulls a string, which lowers the drawbridge that she made, and out come several origami horses who stop at a stream. The camera pulls out to show that the stream is actually Bart's drool, because he's laying on the ground repeatedly saying, "Auga!" imitating a honking truck horn. Having learned her lesson, Marge makes a declaration.
Now that I know better, no DVDs for you kids, just educational television.
We return to Ice Road Hand Fishing.
This has been our way of life since we were pitched the idea by reality show producers.
Welcome to Thieving Bear Chopper Hunt.
Okay, no TV at all. What?
Honey, this sounds like a noble experiment, but like Prohibition, it will end in a hail of bullets.
Fine. No TV for 24 hours.
24 hours? Where'd you pull that crazy number?
We can do without TV for a day. We're taking Maggie to a children's bookstore where she can learn the old-fashioned way, the way children did from 1910 to 2002.
You'll probably agree that Dan Castellaneta's voice as the ice fisher is just really funny.
Yeah.
Because it's Homer, but just like tilted to like, you know, just kind of droll.
Yeah, just hickified like 50%.
Yeah, very funny. And then I like the joke of like Bart, like 24 hours, what kind of odd number? Where'd you get that weird number from? Like not knowing that that's a day.
He is dumb.
Yeah. Hey, Steve, no TV for 24 hours.
Oh, do they have to be 24 consecutive hours?
Yeah.
Ah,
that's easy. Just survive. Take some melatonin, some NyQuil, and Yeah. And you could probably sleep for 24 hours, right?
Oh, yeah. I probably could.
Take 200 milligrams of indica.
Oh, yeah. I'll have my own TV show, which I die several times.
Back to Stephen Coma, sponsored by... Wait, why'd you go, ah?
Because it's horrifying.
Oh.
Probably. For a little bit, then it's probably glorious, but yeah.
What a specific year is 1910 to 2002. I think that's... I'm kind of glad we were part of like the youth that still had to, you know, look up books with the Dewey Decimal System and card catalogs. Well, even at that time when we were young, like computers were starting to be brought into our life and even to schools. You know, we had Oregon Trail and Number Munchers and Word Munchers, but
yeah,
you know, still, and we still had to, you know, type things out on computers for reports, you know, but I, you know, there was times when like, do you remember like still having to write down your like book report and like, or like papers in by hand and then turn it in? And then they proofread it, and then you have to go type it.
I do remember that. It's so weird that we would have to write like 5 pages out on paper, and then we'd type it up, and it'd be like a page.
And you'd ask, like, can we just type it up and send it? Nope, you still have to do long form first. And then, like why would, as a teacher, why would you, you know, in like high school, I was like, why would a teacher want that to happen?
Yeah.
Because then they have to go through it. Then I realized because then, like, my senior year of high school, I became a teacher's assistant. For an English teacher for freshmen, and I had to read.
Fucking
17-year-old kid had to read the freshman kids' papers and proofread them.
That sounds horrible.
Yeah. Why are you trusting, like, one, I'm 17. I don't know everything about the English language. I probably corrected kids' papers, like, oh, you're using the wrong there, even though they probably were using the right there.
Yeah.
Oh, you need a period here. Oh, and you need to put more cursing right here. And probably draw a giant penis over on this paragraph. And that's how I failed being a teacher's assistant.
But I do appreciate the fact that, like, we lived in a time before and after computers because, I don't know, it makes me appreciate it more.
But I think each little step in our technological advances in humanity, that even kids that grew up in, like, 2002 or born 2002, like, every little step, like, there's going to be, you know, when they're 40, there's going to be advancements. Like,
yeah.
I'm so glad we didn't have, you know, holodecks to go travel places, because I used to have to go on a plane to go to, you know, China, but now there's a VR set here in China walking around.
It's true.
Although I'm waiting for that day, because
that sounds awesome.
Yeah. I don't know why, like, people think Wally was, like, negative towards the human race. I'm like, I cannot wait to be the fat dude in a chair, which I kind of already am.
Yeah. I mean, it didn't seem to be offensive to me so much as just like, oh, this is what's going to happen.
And like, it'll be the point where, like, computers were determined to make more humans, but we're not going to actually, like, bone anyone anymore. Like, we will in our fantasies.
Sure.
But not in real life. They'll just distract semen from, like, random people and then.
From our flaccid, useless penises.
Yeah. Thank God we'll all be dead. Every listener here and us will all be dead before that happens.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Well, back to the Simpsons, where even that time, they'll still be making new Simpsons. So the thought of losing TV scares Maggie, which is really funny. So she holds on to the entertainment center as Marge unsuccessfully tries to pull her off. Homer is ready to assist, hitting the eject button on the remote, knocking Maggie on her back. Maggie then grabs disc 5 from the DVD player and sticks her pacifier in the center hole before sucking to relaxed ecstasy. See, can you read that last
thing for me? And I wish I edited sound. Oh, sure. Before sucking to relaxed ecstasy.
All right.
The family then heads to the Land of Forevermore bookstore, which is closing in 3 weeks. Inside, children are causing chaos, running, jumping, and throwing anything in their sights, especially books, such as...
Oh, my God. There's a lot here.
Yeah.
There is, you're tired from some guy named Donald Trump.
Must be a failed TV star or something.
Yeah. But maybe just a failed human being in general.
Yeah.
That was a catchphrase to his, you're fired from the TV show The Apprentice.
Yep. Next we have diarrhea of a wimpy kid. Obvious.
Yeah. Poop jokes are funny though.
Yeah.
But it's probably like a positive book. Like, I'm so wimpy because I got diarrhea all the time. And it's like a, you know, because there's kids that are probably born with irritable bowel syndrome. So it's like a positive, like, you still live life with IBS. Yeah. So positive.
Exactly.
All right. We got The Wind and the Willem Dafoe. Of course, it's The Wind and Willows, an actor, Willem Dafoe. I mean, you could have done like Wind and the Willow Smith.
That's true.
But we're not comedy writers, and that's funny. Or The Wind and Willem Dafoe.
Yeah, I would have made it The Wind and the Willow, but it'd be Mad Mardigan farting on a... Willow Osgood's face.
Do you want to talk about a penis real quick?
Okay.
Willem Dafoe apparently has a really huge hog.
Interesting.
There was a movie. It was called
Spider-Man.
It was called Spider-Man. He's like, want to see my Green Goblin? No. I think it was a Lars von Trier film. He likes to show wieners a lot.
Does.
Speaking of melancholia, that was Lars von Trier, Steve.
Okay.
Okay, so
I just get the two of them confused.
Yeah, so Lars directed a movie called Antichrist, which was Willem Dafoe, and there was a scene where Willem Dafoe's character, his penis was exposed, or was supposed to show his penis, and Lars von was like, no, people are going to be pulled out of that scene because it's too ridiculously big and comedical looking. That they had to hire a stunt penis for Willem Dafoe to make it look like an actual, like, a normal penis, and not Willem Dafoe's. So, but Willem Dafoe looks like a guy. Like, where does he get all that confidence? He's a weird looking dude. Oh, I get it now.
Yeah, there you go. And how must have the stunt actor felt?
I'll let you know, Steve. I got a paycheck and I was happy. That's all.
Okay. I guess that's all that matters.
And now everyone sees Willem Dafoe. I'm like, hey, what's up, small dick? I'm like, at least that's not me.
That's funny. Next we have, speaking of not funny, Kevin James and the Giant Peach, obviously a parody of Roald Dahl's James and the Giant Peach.
With the director of Clerks, Kevin James.
That's right.
That's an inside joke to Kevin Smith's fans.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, next we get The Grinch Who Celebrated Hanukkah, which of course is a parody of The Grinch Who Stole Christmas. And I like that one because it's like, so he was just Jewish the whole time. He's like, no,
I
hate Christmas to celebrate Hanukkah. All these would be great enamel pins, Steve, except for one of them, of course.
Yeah. Next we have The Magic School Bus, Otto's Trip. So, that is what it is.
But didn't he also, like, wasn't there like an episode where he, like, they've made that joke? He's like, knows Mrs. Frizzle or something like that?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. Next, we got Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Uncle, which is a parody of Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day.
That one might be my favorite. Just the bottle of gin really kind of sells it for me.
Is it like an abusive uncle then?
It's either abusive or abusive in a different way. Yeah. Next we have Are You There, Darwin? It's Me, Margaret. This is good for this, the atheists out there. Because, you don't need to believe in Jesus to have a period.
All right, there's our new shirt. The Annoying Grand Boys. You don't have to believe in Jesus to have a period.
That's right.
I like this one, too. How do dinosaurs get divorced?
Next we have another one of my favorites, Corduroy versus Paddington. And I got to say, Paddington, my money's on Paddington. He's a better bear.
All right. And then finally, we got Where the Girls Gone Wild Are. Parody, of course, Where the Wild Things Are, and the popular early 2000s VHSs that you could get on TV, Girls Gone Wild.
What a weird phenomenon that was.
Sorry. Never say phenomenon, Steve.
All right. What a weird occurrence that was.
I know. It was just like, woo. And then when you find out and like you really think about it too, especially like, who is that guy's name? It was like Joe Francis, I believe was the name.
I think so, yeah.
And just like, I mean, he was legit 100% scumbag.
Oh, yeah.
Like nowadays, like, wait, that was a thing? Like, yeah, we just got college girls, supposedly college girls, but wasn't there a lot that were also probably still underage, too? They just,
yeah,
they were. Yeah, very gross, but, you know.
And they never paid them except for like in t-shirts and baseball caps.
Yeah. Which so, now you can probably find all of those at like your local Goodwill.
It's true.
No.
It's bleak.
All right. Well, that was our 20-minute explanation of all the books. But I had a lot of fun with that. It was one of the few, you know, we go through all the sign gags all the time. And
yeah.
And those were all really fun. Yeah. That was probably a fun day in the writer's room.
Yeah, I think so. It's a lot of fun.
Like, well, off your top of your head, would you do The Lord of the Ring? And that's like the ring girl with a crown on it. I don't know.
That's
kind of dumb, but it's just the title of the book. It's almost like mashups, you know, like the
exactly, yeah,
category from Jeopardy.
It's true. And Wheel of Fortune,
but it's gotta be literary, so it's
yeah. The what are books? The Lord of the Fly Girls.
Okay, the girls that danced on Evelyn the Color. All right,
exactly. Harry Potter and the Half Blood, no, the Half Crip Prince, and it features Snoop Dogg as a gangster in Hogwarts.
It's like A Tale of Two Cities, and all I can think of is A Tale of Two Titties.
Yeah.
The Grapes of Wrath of Khan.
I like that. That's a good one. Good Night Moon Knight, based on the popular Disney Plus series.
The Catcher in the Rye with Ham and Cheese.
The Catcher in Ryan Gosling.
The Catcher in the Brown Rye. Enough of this tomfoolery, yeah. Steve. Let's continue with the episode.
Alrighty. So Marge holds Maggie in front of a pile of books while Lisa peruses a copy of The Ugly Duckling Gets a Beak Job. Homer picks up a Cuddle, clearly a parody of Amazon's Kindle, and then he offers the tablet a question. If he buys that, why would he need all these books? The magic mirror face from Snow White then tells him to shut up.
I know, it's weird, like, during this time... Maybe you still can, because Barnes & Noble still exists, but like walking into a Barnes & Noble and they like, have like a whole kiosk of like the Nook. Like,
yeah.
One, the Nook is an inferior reader next to the Kindle, but
it's true.
It's weird. Like, why? Although I do love my Kindle.
Yeah.
Like the reader, not like the one that does all the things.
Right.
The one that actually looks like a book when you turn it on.
That's true. It is nice. And I do like reading comic books on my phone. It's nice.
Yeah. If you have the Kindle... It's not good unless you're reading like comics are black and white.
Yeah.
I actually did read all of The Walking Dead on a Kindle.
Huh. I could see. Wasn't that in black and white?
Or yeah. Maybe, so it was fine.
Yeah. I see that working.
So Marge then shows Maggie that instead of watching TV, they can read children's books written by TV stars. Then, of course, we see the affirmation works by Kevin James. And then we see Krusty, who's signing copies of a new book he edited, A Child's Garden of Milli Vanilli Jokes. When one kid asks who Milli Vanilli is, Krusty responds that he doesn't know and reminds the boy that there are no refunds. Steve, tell the kids who Milli Vanilli was.
Well, way back in the day, way back in, let's say, 1989, there were two probably German guys who wanted to be pop stars, but they couldn't sing that well. So they got studio musicians to sing for them, and then they'd appear on TV, and they would lip sync the songs Girl, You Know It's True, and another one. And then they got a Grammy for it in 1990. But then they realized their secret was exposed and they were no longer allowed to sing because they were caught lip syncing. And so they were laughed into obscurity. And then I think one of them committed suicide.
What a uplifting tale. All right. Marge and Maggie then discover that the bookstore has a storyteller, while Homer, in this clip, makes some discoveries of his own.
Look, Maggie, they have a story lady.
One day, Silly Sally said, let's have a sloppy, gloppy supper. First, they slurped their soup. Slurp, slurp, slurp. Then they chewed their bread. Chew, chew, chew. More soup. Oh, I could slurp this soup forever. Slurp, slurp.
Sorry, folks, she doesn't even work here.
Spot the hidden objects. Boy, you're pretty pushy for a book I just met. Gotcha! Candy cane in the umbrella stand. All this trick in the book.
All right. The children's book reader, that's probably Tress, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Just another one of her great voices. Like, anytime she just does a voice on The Simpsons that's, you know, not a recurring character, it's just delightful.
Always. It just puts a smile on my face every time.
Just reminds you of, like a kindergarten teacher that reads to the kids, you know? Like, like the slurp, slurp. The cadence. And, yeah, the tone of her voice. Just give her an award right now, Steve.
All right, here you go, Tress. You are delight.
Like... Homer just be mad at the book of spot the hidden object. Kind of pushy.
For a book. No, Craig, did you ever have a subscription to Highlights magazine?
Probably.
Yeah.
I think every kid probably. I mean, I don't know. I just remember that my only like Highlights recollections are like going to like the doctors or dentists and just like looking at it there.
I just remember I had an aunt who would always get me for Christmas or my birthday a set of personalized pencils with my name on them. And then subscription to Zoo Books and Highlights magazine.
Wow. I mean, I have that same memory. So I remember the pencils and Zoo Books. You just brought me back. Yeah, definitely had those.
Yeah.
Zoo Books. Those were cool because like, and I remember like going to the zoo as a kid and like they always had like all the issues that you could buy. And I just remember like, I want the dinosaur one.
Yeah.
And I'm like, why aren't there dinosaurs in the zoo?
Probably couldn't afford them.
No.
Fucking fancy Asian zoos. They have them.
Fucking also like that rich tycoon Hammond has them.
Yeah.
All on this like island off of Costa Rica. Jerk.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Oh my God. Is that Hammond? What's your first name?
Daryl.
Daryl Hammond. I loved you in The Ladies Man. I'm sure you were in that movie.
Yeah.
Dino DNA.
That's what The Ladies Man got all over the girls. Tim. I never saw The Lady Man. I love I love SNL. There's some of those SNL movies. I think I stopped watching them after Wayne's World 2.
Yeah, I think I've seen probably a third of The Ladies' Man on a Saturday afternoon on Comedy Central in like 2002. Wow.
Yeah, never seen The Ladies' Man, never saw The Night of the Roxbury, never saw Superstar. What was the last SNL character movie?
Ooh, that's a great question. I feel like Superstar might be up there.
Yeah. I don't think they made a Stefan movie, but if they did, it'd probably make a lot of money.
Oh yeah.
No, but it'd be like really not funny at all. It'd be like that character doesn't work as a character.
Right.
Like in a movie.
The last one is from 2010. Do you want to try and guess what it is?
Jesus. 2010. That's probably during the time like Tina Fey, Amy Poehler years. But maybe those characters weren't in those seasons, right?
Yes. I'll give you another hint. It was also turned into a television show.
Jesus. Yeah, have you seen this 2010 SNL movie?
No. Although it's probably good.
And it's turned into a TV show. And
it's probably a TV show in the past like couple years.
Past couple of years?
Yeah.
Is it like a Lonely Island movie? But does that count?
Nope.
Okay.
But Pop Star Never Stop Stopping is a very good movie.
Yeah. Duh, MacGruber.
You got it.
Yeah. Fucking, I love MacGruber.
Yeah.
All right. So they went off on a high note.
Yeah, exactly.
Can't believe I forgot that. All right. Well, back at The Simpsons, at the Van Houten residence, Milhouse feels for Bart, who can't watch TV for 24 hours. Milhouse couldn't go a day without the Doctors of Oz and Phil and Gupta. And so far, we have a Dr. Oz and a Trump joke.
It's true. Ugh. And that's also Sanjay Gupta is the only like halfway respectable doctor in the bunch.
Yeah, I forgot Phil's a dickhead. So Bart agrees and shouts, epoxy fight. He then blasts his cock all over Milhouse's head, covering his hair in sticky white goo. I don't know why I said it like that. Anyway, so Milhouse asks, what the hell is an epoxy fight? Which I was, that's a really funny line for Milhouse to say, what the hell?
Yeah.
I don't like that. Bart lets out the last bits of his spent tube, causing a little bit more of that sticky white stuff to ooze out down Milhouse's pearly white face.
I don't know why you had to make it so gross, Craig.
I don't know.
Pervert.
Yeah.
Milhouse pulls his hand away from his epoxy-covered head, taking some hair with it. Bart tells his friend not to worry, saying that'll clean it up. First, Bart requests some whipped cream and a pair of safety scissors. He says scissors as a singular bothers me. When that proves unsuccessful,
here's my scissor.
Yeah. I don't know why. It's a pair of pants, a pair of scissors. It's just fine.
It's not, would you like a pair of pant?
Yeah. If I ask for a pair of pant, I want two dogs that are warm. Two hot dogs, if you will.
Mustard and onions.
Yum, yum.
Arf, arf.
When that proves unsuccessful, Bart says he just needs a cigarette lighter and some sandpaper. And when that doesn't work, Bart decides to just use a razor. So Bart shaves the top of Milhouse's head, leaving a horseshoe of hair. Milhouse is stunned, but Bart sees this as an opportunity.
Oh my God, you look just like your dad. Let's see how far we can take this. And finally, the tie.
I always wanted to wear a necktie. Mom says they make you more
of a man.
Now sing the alphabet song. A,
B,
C,
D,
E,
F,
G,
H,
I,
J,
K, L, M, N. O. What if we Van Houten to the max?
Whoa, that's a little too tight. Oh yeah.
Nah, back to the sweet spot. Milhouse, if people believe you're a grown-up, we could do anything.
Like we go to a movie theater and pay full price? That would be awesome!
Okay, first tone it down. Time to teach you to be a man.
What, now I'm not pulling it off?
Milhouse is his daddy.
And it's really weird that I think last week's episode, I made like a dumb joke of Milhouse was always Kirk Van Houten all the time and like they didn't exist or Milhouse didn't exist. And then this happens, like this is really fucking weird.
It is very strange.
And it's very fun how you go from Pamela Hayden, who's done Milhouse, and then you go to Hank, who's doing Kirk.
Yeah.
Which I imagine like they probably record the whole dialogue and then Hank did the whole dialogue just to edit that. And then going all the way up to, because Hank also does Duff Man.
Yeah.
It was really fun. I like that scene. It was good.
That's fun. A friend shaving another friend's head bald feels a little familiar to me.
Why is that?
Well, you know, It's almost like when I was like, let's say 25, and I needed a haircut because my blonde hair was getting too long. And my roommate and best friend said, hey, I know somebody who can cut it. And they work next door to a salon, and they're friendly with the employees there. And so I thought, hey, that sounds like a great idea. But instead of bringing anybody from the salon, they brought over a forestry major. And then she had a pair of scissors, and the friend had a pair of clippers. And they each took half of the head until like 10 minutes later, that person was me, was completely bald. That'd be weird if that happened.
Wow, your friend was a real jerkhole.
Nah, it's fine.
You know what? You know what? No. This is what your friend gets.
You're a real jerk. You know that?
Yeah.
That's fair.
Luckily, you don't still know him and do a podcast with him every week.
That's right. Also in the world of stuff that's coincidental, this is really interesting because there's a show called Bob's Burgers, which also airs on Sunday Night on Fox. And the 12th episode of the third season, which aired 2 weeks to the day before this episode, it's called Broadcast Wagstaff School News, features a plot point where the son, played by Eugene Merman in the cartoon, shaves the back of his head to make a bald spot and uses that hair to grow to glue a mustache to his face, making himself look just like his dad, Bob, the titular Bob of Bob's Burgers.
I know we're a Bob's Burgers podcast now.
Just a little bit. It's just funny. Like, I'm not saying anybody stole anything, but it's just kind of funny how they had that kind of parallel thinking.
So it was the same time that this episode aired, this happened.
Yeah.
That is weird. I know that I've seen like coincidences like that before where like I think Family Guy does a similar story, then the next week The Simpsons and vice versa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it also feels like so close together that nobody's like ripping each other off. It's just a happy accident.
Again, there's only like 12 stories you can tell.
Exactly. And the one where you shave your head to look like your father is number 7.
And that was Shakespeare's favorite.
Yeah.
I think it happened to like Othello. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Thou shalt look like King Lear, mine daddy.
All right. Well, back in The Simpsons, we get a montage accompanied by other pixies. Here comes your man. When we see Bart and Milhouse doing adult things, such as enjoying a pipe and some brandy in front of a fireplace. It does sound very fun to do.
It does.
Though the brandy, of course, is actually apple juice, and the pipe is full of soap bubbles. That doesn't sound as fun.
No. I mean, soap bubbles would be kind of fun.
Yeah. Apple juice and just make your tummy hurt, you know. You have to read a diary of a wimpy kid because if you drink too much apple juice.
That's right.
Next, the boys play in a band called Men, which with Bart on the lead guitar, Milhouse on the rhythm guitar, and Milhouse's Shih Tzu on the drums. I think it's just kind of funny because it's just they're trying to do manly things, and their band's called Men.
Yeah.
I mean, they aren't wearing hats, so they should have been men without hats.
I mean, they are literally men without hats.
And, yes. You know, they're kind of working, so they should have been men at work.
Mm-hmm.
And they were kind of like boys becoming men, so they could have been boys to men.
It's very true.
Instead of drinking that brandy, they should have had a Manhattan.
Manhattan.
Bart and Milhouse Santin.
That's a good drink.
Yeah.
A Bart Manhattan.
Bart Manhattan. There we go.
There we go.
That's going to be the name of my cocktail.
Do the Bart Manhattan.
Okay. All right. And so Milhouse then takes some of his father's medication, which is Easy Peasy Urine Flow Enhancer, which causes him to flail about while urinating. Like, this scene was really funny. It's like,
yeah.
It's like when you like someone has like a fire hose and like they flail up, but like also like he's got both hands on his hog.
Does he working with the Defoe?
Milhouse has a huge hog.
Wow.
Because even like there's scenes where he's like kind of like down towards the floor, but his hog's still on the toilet area.
That's true.
Milhouse is a Defoe. Milhouse and Liam Neeson and Willem Dafoe all the same affliction.
Well hung.
Yeah, there you go.
So in Kirk's home office, in front of a torn family portrait that has been taped up, Milhouse sets up auto pay for the gas bill. Bart's impressed, but now it's time for Milhouse's final test. In the Simpsons living room, Homer uses the condensation from his duff can to make rings around the hidden objects in his book. And suddenly, Lisa receives a call on her phone, but it's not Zoom, because it's Skype, the only game in town at this point.
Yeah, who cares about Skype? We're all about Zoom.
That's right, Zoom, Zoom, Zoom.
Oh, great. Another invasive Skype from Milt, huh?
Hello, Lisa. This is my daddy. I mean, Kirk Van Houten. May I speak to your father, please?
He's right here.
Homer, Bart would like to spend the night at our house, and he has my permission.
Sure, what do I care?
Not so fast!
Huh?
I also want to say that Bart is a remarkable boy, and I disapprove of your fathering and of your fat stomach.
Sorry.
Give him anything he wants. Bigger allowance, a new bike, just do it.
Whatever you say, sir.
Dad, why are you kowtowing to Mr. Van Houten?
Sometimes it's just so nice to have a man take charge.
And in 10 years, make Lisa go to the prom with Milhouse.
Dad?
Grown-ups have their reasons.
Oh.
Now, I want you to eat a gallon of ice cream in under 2 minutes.
But I just did that.
You now have 1 minute, 55 seconds.
This is my daddy.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. There's also like a nervousness in Hank's voice that I really appreciate. Like, he's like, he's a little extra nervous, even more so than Kirk normally is.
This is a very dumb premise, but it pulls off so well, I think.
I agree. Like, it's a silly, stupid episode, and that's not necessarily a bad thing.
No. We're not showing our cards yet, but yeah, exactly.
So Homer quickly stuffs his face full of ice cream while Bart and Milhouse laugh. Milhouse could get used to being an adult. And then on the computer screen, ice cream oozes out of Homer's nose, much like the epoxy dripping down Milhouse's face.
Oh, yeah. In the Van Houten garage, we begin our second act, as it always begins, with Bart taping a pillow to Milhouse's gut. He then tapes Milhouse to the paint cans that he's standing on, resulting in Milhouse being the same height as his father, and Milhouse awkwardly takes a few steps forward to a shelf where he can now reach poisons with their inviting skull and crossbones. I just love how, like, he looks just like, I mean, they did a good job of making him look like his dad, but the short arms just
yeah,
and the way, like, they keep the whole walking thing throughout the episode, it's really funny.
It is. Later, Luann comes home and sees Milhouse as Kirk wearing a shirt that she bought him. Luann assumed that Kirk hated the shirt, but Milhouse replies that he loves it when Luann buys clothes for him, since she knows what is itchy and what's not. Itchy's a cat. No, itchy's a mouse.
The mouse, yeah, because Scratchy has cat in it.
That's right. Luann kisses what she assumes is her husband, Kirk Evelyn Van Houten. Milhouse wishes his dad could have been there to see his parents kiss, which is a very sweet and confusing sentence. Bart is more interested in Milhouse obtaining Kirk's license, which has revoked stamped on it, and the word non written in front of the stamp, so it says non-revoked.
Were you hoping that later on the episode there's going to be a scene where Milhouse is in bed with Luann? It's probably because I was just watching Game of Thrones. I'm like, come on, incestual stuff has to happen.
Right. He can have a new son, brother.
She'd be like, oh, Kirk, did you take penile enhancements? You remind me of my ex-boyfriend, Willem Dafoe. That's just Milhouse's dick. I mean, my dick.
This daddy's dick.
I knew this episode would get very dirty because there's some.
Yeah.
But it might just end here.
Yeah, well, we're done with it now.
I've already talked about Willem Dafoe's penis and Milhouse's penis and alluded to Milhouse having sex with his mother, Oedipus style.
And ejaculating on Bart's face, too.
Yeah, I feel like I was forced to say that.
You have your own free will. More or less.
All right. So Bart and Milhouse head to You Rent It, and Milhouse proudly states that he rented a truck. And then on the road, Milhouse says with pride that he's driving a truck. And then the truck is wrapped around a tree. And Milhouse happily declares that he crashed a truck. And over at the Easy Rent, Milhouse says that he rented another truck. And then, he swerves his new rental into the mailbox in front of the Quickie Mart. Yeah, this is a very funny scene. And then outside the convenience store, our favorite bullies, Jimbo, Dolph, and Kearney, are loitering, the worst crime anyone can commit.
That's right.
Hey, Simpson, don't you have a lame dad of your own?
Oh, I give you all my money, but my wallet is Velcro too tight.
You're the wussiest adult I've ever seen.
An adult? He's buying it.
Kirk, remember, you have the superpowers of a middle-aged man.
Hello, Mr. Kirk.
I want to buy this beer, cigarettes, magazines with boobs, and 3 pairs of sunglasses.
Polarized!
I suspect you are buying for underage bullies. But as that is 98% of my business, I say thank you, sir. Come again.
Yo, Bart, your growing man friend is all right.
I like in that they're showing the weapons, and Kearney he's slapping a tarantula in his hand as a weapon. It's fun.
It is very funny. The and magazines then, that they're reading, we get Rustler, which is a parody of a hustler.
Which is probably just women taking off bad jeans.
And then we get Play Dude, which, of course, is their ongoing parody of the hit magazine, Playboy. And then we get Barely Beagle,
huh?
With like dogs on her. So it's like a dog porn pet magazine.
And is Dolph into that? Is his real name Rolf?
It's Snoop Dogg's favorite magazine. Does even go by Snoop Dogg?
I was going to say Snoopy.
Remember when we were kids, he was Snoop Doggy Dog.
That's right.
What was he for a brief moment? Lion?
Snoop Lion.
Snoop
yeah.
Lion, yeah. And now he's just Mr. Martha Stewart.
Mr. Bic spokesperson himself.
Mr. Corona Man.
That's right. Ad Man for Hire Dog.
Could you imagine going to a young Calvin Brodus who was, you know, grew up in the gangs in L.A.?
Mm-hmm.
Like, here, this is your future. You do ads for Corona, Bic, and apparently the world sees you as best friends with Martha Stewart.
Yeah. Then we go over to Ice-T and, okay, you're a pimp now, but in 30 years, you're going to play a cop on TV
who
solves crimes involving pimps. And that's it. You don't rap anymore, though you were in a metal band for a second. And you marry a white woman with a big ass. And he's probably like, cool.
Yeah. And then you go to Daryl McDaniels, DMC from Rum DMC or Jam Master J. And they're like, here's you are in the future. You're still nerds who rap. And they're like, that's all we wanted.
That's all we wanted. Am I still wearing Adidas? You sure are. Cool.
But now they own Reeboks. Oh, what? Yeah. Reeboks? No.
So impressed with the results, the bullies considered threatening more adults. Jimbo worries that that would make them criminals rather than bullies. And Kearney suggests that they beat up a philosopher until they find an answer. Very funny. As Bart and Milhouse hit the road, Milhouse notes that he made his mother happy and he got through the bullies without a punch. To Milhouse, being an adult, super easy.
Yeah, I agree, Milhouse. I mean, the easiest things are being an adult, being a parent. I mean,
yeah.
I don't have a kid, but personally, I think like it's probably the easiest like thing you'd ever do in your life.
It's the easiest, most thankful job you have.
Yeah.
Everybody appreciates all your work, and it's not that much work anyway.
It's only 16 years of work if you're lucky.
Yeah.
There's 2 years that you just don't give a shit.
Right.
And I'm not saying it's from 16 to 18.
No, it's any 2 years.
Yeah. Any 2 years you get off as a parent.
Yeah. You get bye weeks or bye years.
It's obviously those 2 years the kids are in middle school because they want nothing to do with you as a parent.
Right.
So those are your years. You can do whatever you want. Like your kids don't want to hang out with you. They don't want to be around you. When they're 13 to 15, just let them away. Don't even do anything.
Because they're probably smelly assholes at that time anyway. So leave them alone.
Yeah. They'll appreciate you when they like turn 33.
Yeah. So Bart digs through the products they bought and takes out a condom with Milhouse. He blows it up and pops it in Milhouse's face.
That's like Milhouse the worst condom ever. Like,
I know.
That's probably Krusty brand condom. Like,
ew. I just wouldn't want to buy a Krusty condom.
hey, vagina. Or butthole. I don't care.
So Bart blows
it's
it up.
It's okay to practice safe sex.
Yeah.
Safe
sex is good sex. And consensual sex is the best sex. He blows it up and pops it in Milhouse's face. Milhouse calls Bart a dope, saying that those are intended for her pleasure. So she should have been the one to blow it up and pop it in somebody's face.
Kids are dumb. I love it.
Yep.
Well, it's Milhouse's turn to live out a fantasy involving adult themes.
Mm.
Excited for that, Steve.
Oh, yeah.
So he's going to behind a curtain. And boy, oh boy, will he come out a man, Steve. I know that curtain's probably the adult theater, right?
Yeah, he's going to look at some porno videos.
He's going to put his huge hog in a glory hole that goes into the next glory hole. He's going to be like, the next person that walks into that booth, like, why is there a railing right here of skin tone? But no, Steve, he's in a voting booth. Ah. I was hoping for nudity on The Simpsons. Yeah. All right. So Milhouse ponders his electoral options, and then he's rudely interrupted. I think we will play a clip here. So let's play a clip about his voting. And then later in this clip, let's get Bart and Milhouse visiting the old Moe's.
More money for schools. That could translate into more homework.
I know this is highly illegal, but you're not leaving this booth till you punch yes.
Don't bother screaming for help. This is a municipal off-cycle election.
There's no one for miles.
Don't forget your sticker.
Hey, bartender. We'd like two milks, and then you can tell us where babies come from.
Ah, well, in my case, my mom was hit with a voodoo curse. I gestated for 5 years, then I popped out backwards and on fire.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Keep my tail right here in his jaw. Good times.
I love that it's the municipal off-cycle election, which happens occasionally, like, in your district. And it's just like, at that point, you're just like, I don't really care.
Yeah, there'll be, like, one candidate.
Yeah.
And, like one issue
that it's like, raise the taxes 0.002% for more popsicle sticks in the nurse's lounge or the nurse's office, you know. But it's weird because, like, in the primaries, too, like, that's kind of like we're in this off-cycle every 2 years election. But for my area, I mean, that was like a huge election because we're just in the primary. So like at this point now, I'm not going to take anything that I get a ballot for granted. I'm just going to make sure I know what I'm voting for. Like,
yeah,
just because I think we voted dumb in the past. This time, like, just as voters, like, just pay attention to what you believe in and what you think and vote that way, you know?
Yeah. Educate yourself a little bit, and not a political podcast, but just, you know, inform yourself. It's good civil duty.
Right.
And to change the topic slightly, isn't it interesting that this week's episode has Mo pouring milk? And we talked last week about Mo keeping milk in the bar. And also, he was born of a voodoo curse, much like that theme last week.
From the week previous. Yeah.
Yeah.
So many connections. I think we talked about it too on the podcast, like, let's find the connection from the previous podcast. I think we've kind of have, but
yeah,
but we're gonna definitely do it now.
Yeah, there it is right there.
All right, well, let's go back to 742 Evergreen Terrace, where the littlest of Simpsons, Maggie, watches the clothes spinning in the dryer,
which they must have moved up from the basement.
I thought they were in the basement.
No, they're right next to the kitchen.
Oh, let me look at that scene real quick. Oh, you're right. Oh, you're right. It's like it's almost like probably the hallway where the rumpus room is, where they never go into.
Yeah.
It's like, throw a washer and dryer there. Maybe they're, you know how the Simpsons are, like, they have, you know, the joke of, like, they have enough money, like, they're supposed to be blue collar, middle class Americans, which doesn't exist anymore.
Right.
Like, you know, when we were kids, I always thought that people that had a refrigerator in the garage and in their kitchen were rich.
Oh, yeah. Soda fridge. That was the coolest thing ever.
Yeah. Daddy's liquid was in there, as my friends would say.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have friends. But, like, what if they have, like, the washer and dryer upstairs for, like, you know, your basic, just, like, you know, some clothes. But then downstairs is more of the industrial stuff, or, like, linens and things like that.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, it's just the Simpsons logic of, like, we need the scene to go from here to there. Let's just put it.
Yeah.
I would Lisa be in there. It's dumb. But, yeah, good catch. Good catch.
Thank you.
Lisa does recognize that Maggie is missing the TV. So Marge turns her around to see her eyes spinning, much like the dryer. Marge then turns the pacifier like a dial, because it's a cartoon, causing the swirling eyes to stop. Stupid Lisa Garbage Face suggests that they take Maggie down to pick up some culture. You know, the Jazzles, featuring Dizzy Gillespie's tribute band with the trumpeter that has the puffiest cheeks.
Ooh.
Yeah, Marge is unsure since the U.S. Embassy has urged people not to go down to downtown Springfield. I think they declared not going down to downtown Portland lately. It's a war zone down there, Steve. Lisa is disappointed, but not surprised, being the middle child who never gets what she wants.
Lisa then mentions a puppet show that she's aware of, and we cut to the Lithuanian Center, which is offering a puppet spelled P-U-P-P-P-I-T-T show, with a marquee saying, maybe that's how we spell it, you don't know. And inside, a marionette describes a brutal scene before being massacred herself.
Long before the Teutonic slaughters visited upon our people, there was the massacre of by Mstislav of Kiev in 1132.
Maybe we should go.
Nobody leave till every puppet dead.
Can I ask a question about this whole scene?
Sure.
So did Bart put on this puppet show?
It sounds like it, yeah.
He's not in the audience.
And it's clearly his voice.
I don't get this whole scene at all. I'm not saying I hate this, but, like, I just don't understand, like, what does this have to do with, like, you know, this whole episode is short as it is.
Yeah, and this is kind of a throwaway.
It's a throwaway. I don't get this scene at all.
It is very weird.
It's funny.
Yeah.
because you don't need the whole Maggie missing TV, because it's not a story point in this whole episode.
Right.
It's just one bit.
Right.
Like, they couldn't have done another bit with Homer doing the
find a thing.
They could have added a little bit more to that. It right. didn't need it, but they could have added just like maybe, you know, like he's at work and can't find a donut because there's so many circular objects that are pink for some reason.
Yeah. Yeah.
Find the right donut. I mean, it's just a weird like scene. I don't hate the scene. It doesn't.
No.
It's not offensive.
I feel funny. Like you're right, though. I feel like it was like in somebody's mind and they wanted to use it somewhere.
Yeah.
And they just kept on pitching it. Like, what about that Lithuanian puppet show? And we're like, OK, fine. You can have it now, Matthew Nastuk. You're the director.
Well, maybe it was
Gammill and Pross.
Maybe it was like Gammill and Pross are of Ukrainian descent. And Mr. Lav, the first of Kiev, was a descendant. And they're just like, I'm going to honor you someday.
Yes. And they tried it on Seinfeld. Never happened. They right. tried it on The Critic. Never happened. They even tried to throw it into Son of Mask.
Yeah. That was the whole point. Like, they wanted Mr. Lav to be the villain.
Yeah. That guy over there, he's smoking. Those Lithuanian people.
Oh, Jesus. But yeah, weird scene. So here we go.
Yeah. So back at the Simpsons house, Lisa steps into Bart's bedroom, curious as to what he wanted to show her. Bart is busy honing a prank, taking Nelson's advice to remove, quote, in the butt from his kick me sign, because it's just not necessary. So good on Nelson for the constructive feedback.
He should probably edit our podcast.
Yeah. Remove all the times we say in the butt. Bart tells his sister that he knows of a cool adult who can take Lisa to the jazz hole. Milhouse, dressed as Kirk, steps out of the closet and says hello to Lisa in his adult voice. Lisa immediately recognizes Bart's weird, horny friend. She thinks that he might be able to get through the bouncer, but it doesn't matter since they don't have enough money for the gas and the cover fee. But Bart, as he always does, has a plan.
Au contraire, starfish hair. The Baby Poindexter Company is being forced to pay a settlement to any parent who had enough misguided love to buy their videos.
They're not gonna write a check to a couple of kids.
Then I will be your guy's dad.
Thanks, but lowering your voice and standing on paint cans doesn't make you man enough to be my dad.
Hmm. All right, can I get a subscription to Highlights Magazine?
Homer, that's for children.
Where does it say that?
Read the rest of the title.
Highlights for... Go!
Yeah. Highlights joke. So good.
It's great. It's a great joke.
Highlights for... I mean, you saw it coming, but I loved it.
Yeah, me too.
Also, like Bart referring to his sister as starfish hair. Au contraire, starfish hair.
Yeah, it's fun. It's very fun. We haven't heard that before.
It only took 23 years.
That's right.
Steve, can we get to our final act?
I suppose.
All right. It begins like every final act of The Simpsons does, with Homer circling hidden items in a children's book. His wife, played by Marge, steps into the bedroom complaining that she's lost one of her earrings. And then Homer scans the room, and in a bowl of candy N&Ns, he sees the pearl earring. He tosses it to Marge, followed by a lost thimble from a Monopoly game, a $25 casino chip, which Marge is all like, oh, thank God, I love it.
Yeah.
Very funny. And then the smallest of nesting dolls, which also makes Marge very horny.
Yeah.
It's all very horny for Marge because she has Homer. If he can find anything else that he likes in the bed.
Oh.
Yeah, he says, just his honey pie.
Oh, yeah.
Which is what Marge thinks is his her pet name for vagina.
Uh-huh.
No, but that's what the audience thinks, not Marge. Because Marge actually offers him the dessert of a honey pie.
Mm-hmm.
They shut the lights off, and then they have intercourse. But not really, because it's Homer licking the wrapper. You think he's performing cunnilingus, you see.
Of course. Really,
he's performing Eatalingus.
Eatalingus.
Yeah.
It's going to be the name of my restaurant. Eatalingus.
Yeah, welcome to my... a very stereotypical Italian accent, which you're allowed to do still.
We make eating out fun. We've got extra napkins in case you make a mess.
Millennials love it.
Yeah.
Because the restaurant is located in the back.
Yeah, you got to go through the back door. Lisa, Bart, and Milhouse arrive at the bus depot in downtown Springfield. The boys have a physical altercation which offends a snake-owning wino. And later, the kids receive their rebate from the fine folks at Lazy Parent Education Videos, Inc., producers of the Baby Poindexter series.
There you go. One adult and two children one way downtown.
As adults, what do we do now? Shake hands?
If you like.
And that's how you do it, huh?
Now remember, I can't sit backwards or I get sick.
Well, if I look at your face, I get sick.
Young man, apologize to your sister.
Make me baldy.
Are you little?
My adulthood!
I never thought I'd say this, but that is conduct unbecoming of a bus station. Where'd your babies go?
Your intellect-deadening DVDs turned my brother's brain to jelly.
Pretty shapes tell me to kill everybody.
Looks like you're entitled to the full rebate of $19.95.
That's all you pay for screwing up a child for life?
Thinking they were going to get hundreds of dollars. That's like when you like get a letter in the mail for like a product or whatever, you know, your phone service. Like, there is a $4 billion breach of information through, you know, T-Mobile, and you're entitled to a settlement. Please go to this website. And you realize like the settlement's for like $13. You're like, I don't really have time to do this bullshit.
So I'll have you know, Craig, that I am currently involved with a class action lawsuit.
Oh, no. Was it for extends? The mail?
It was. It made it smaller somehow. I don't know what's inside of me.
But you still were peeing, moving around like a...
Yeah.
Yeah, I have the settlement for Willem Dafoe's clone penis. I don't know.
No, it's for a company I used to work for. I won't name them, but they're...
Oh, can I name them?
Sure.
Willem Dafoe's Extend the Penis brand of penis pills.
That's right.
Not only were you a spokesman, you were a client.
That's right. No, it's for a coffee company that I used to work for.
Pete's Coffee.
Yeah, we'll say that. And when I left them, I evidently did not receive all of my tips. So next month, I should receive hundreds of dollars from them.
Well, that's kind of cool.
It is, yeah.
I love the beginning of that clip when the bus depot, like, Milhouse doesn't know how to be an adult. And like, do we shake hands now? Like, it's very kind of like earnest and like endearing that like, oh, adults like have this decorum of like civility and like properness that he thinks that. I mean, that's what we did when we were kids. Like, you think like adults are so proper, prim and proper. And
yeah.
But no, we just not. Say the same dirty shit we did when we were kids.
Yeah,
we
I like just, that the
we just learned new depot, jokes.
Yeah, I like that the bus depot attendant too was also as socially awkward as Kirk and just kind of went along with it.
I couldn't tell the voice. Is that the sound kind of like maybe Nancy Cartwright, aka Bart Simpson, doing like a Kirk impersonation?
Yeah, which makes you think, do they like all sit around and make fun of each other? So you have like Dan doing a Marge impersonation, Harry Sheard making fun of Nancy Cartwright as well. Be funny.
I mean, you know, back, I mean, most Simpsons fans knows that back in the days they did all the recordings together, but now everyone just records separate, especially like past COVID, where I don't even know if like they even have to leave their house anymore, much like this podcast.
We were ahead of the curve. So Milhouse decides to take matters into his own hands, requesting the rebate in singles and nickels. All he has to do is sign the document, but he asks if it has to be in cursive. The Lazy Parent Video spokesperson says an X is fine, but Milhouse is still worried about writing that X in cursive.
So then Lisa is upset because they have just enough money to make it home, and she's hungry now. But Milhouse complains that he's been walking on pancakes all day when Lisa finds something. So at the stay-at-night hotel, they're offering a free breakfast for a 90-minute condo sales pitch presentation. Lisa urges Milhouse not to buy a condo, but Milhouse wonders, what if they can't afford not to buy it?
It's true. You never know. In the Simpsons kitchen, Homer is flipping through a Where's Waldo book, easily finding the striped-shirted nomad. Marge comes in, concerned, saying that Bart told them they were going to the Van Houtens, while Luann was informed that the kids would be going to the Simpsons. Homer vows to get his kids back because they just bought them new shoes. He finds the final two Waldos, and they head out to find their children. Marge assumes they went to the jazz club, and Homer wonders how many lives jazz will corrupt.
So in the meeting room of the stay-night hotel, two more diners sneak out, leaving only Milhouse, Bart, and Lisa. The presenter offers multiple versions of the exact same room when Bart puts his foot down, and later, in this clip, Milhouse gets a boner.
Boing.
Now, let me give you the 14 different apartment configurations. The Hacienda, the Urban Oasis, Castle in the Sky, Connecticut Sunset.
Lady, my stomach's full and I want to go. That's how it works in this country.
If you try to leave, you'll find the doors are locked.
Well, before our dad signs any contracts, he has a surprise for you.
Oh, I hope it's that he's single.
Oh, I'm single. Though some days I have a girl buddy on field trips.
You're a bit of a freak. I like that.
You're the adult.
Kirk, don't you have something to tell her?
Just looking for a casual hookup?
Yeah, for my Thomas the Tank engines.
Ooh, I love how I don't exactly understand what you're saying.
Tress, also the...
Yeah.
She thinks that Thomas the Tank engine is genitalia. So Milhouse is, in my mind, Milhouse has banged his mom and now he's going to bang her.
Yeah.
All right.
Go for it, Milhouse.
This is such an absurd, like, hilarious scene for me, but it's funny.
Yeah, he's really going to earn the name Thrillhouse. For all the thrills that he gives the ladies. So Homer and Marge frantically drive through Springfield looking for the children. Marge asks Homer if he sees anything, and at first he doesn't. But just then he spies Mayor Quimby in his underpants using his sash to sneak out of a hotel room window. He then witnesses Professor Frink stepping out of a marriage counseling office, pleading with his robot lover that her necessary software update was not a criticism. And then the android woman smokes a cigarette, ignoring the professor. There's something very funny about a robot smoking a cigarette.
It is very funny. So finally, Homer and Marge arrive at the Stay Night Hotel. Homer sees free breakfast, and he knows he found what he was looking for. But Marge, of course, assumes that he means, like, the kids. And he says, yeah, they could be there, too. Anyways, inside, Milhouse continues to be seduced, while also in this clip, Marge and Homer burst in. And then later, we'll find out what happens when Milhouse faces his father.
Ooh, I love how your arms are too short and thin for your legs. Just like a crocodile.
I'm feeling a strange, refreshing brew of emotion. So yeah!
Milhouse? How'd you know it was me? The top of your head has a 5 o'clock shadow.
Your hair is growing back.
Tell me your secret.
He's 10 years old.
Oh, there's always a catch.
Is anyone here going to buy a condo?
It's gonna be yes, but don't rush me.
And worst of all, you cast my vote. Who did you vote for in the nonpartisan judicial election?
Williamson.
No, no, no!
I'm really sorry, Dad. But I have to say, it was pretty cool having your life.
You mean that?
I'd be happy to wind up just like you.
I hope you remember that when I can't pay for your college. Now, how would you like to go to your own parent-teacher interview while I see a movie?
I'd like that.
Kirk is such a dirtbag. Like, even when Milhouse is saying, like, oh, you're such a good dad, and I didn't hate living your life. He's like, cool, I'm going to go to a movie. You play you play me in your parents' teacher conference because I don't want to deal with it. It's funny.
I do like that simplistic, like, simple ending for, like, and it's resolved. Like, he doesn't really care.
Yeah.
Maybe that's a good message of, like, Kirk's not a great father, but Homer and Marge are great parents because they're still together. Is this, like, a weird message, like, parents need to be together for a child to be fully...
Ugh.
Yeah. Maybe I'm just coming up with the wrong kind of message.
Yeah.
I skipped that. Phil, edit that out.
Okay.
Steve, who's Phil?
No, he just showed up one day.
Can I have jelly beans now? Does he want jelly beans?
Somebody feed Phil.
I only like the licorice jelly beans.
Sounds like a cool dude. I like him. Hey, Phil, you want to get a beer afterwards?
I don't drink beer.
Sorry. You're fired.
Okay, Mr. Blippi.
Hi, Phil.
What the hell was that?
I don't know. It's weird. Okay,
we need a new editor.
Yeah.
All right. We're almost done with The Simpsons here. Let's just wrap it up, Steve, okay?
Alrighty.
So as the Van Houtens walk away, Homer asks Bart to promise to never look like him. Bart replies that he sure hopes he never looks like his father, causing Homer to choke him. You know, you gotta get a Homer choking this kid in The Simpsons. This might be one of the last ones, too. We don't know.
True, yeah.
He's saying it's not a heartwarming thing to end on. And then, of course, we get a heartwarming song from the Pixies. And that's how the series ends. I mean...
Wow.
Let's just say this episode is that way.
Yeah, okay. That's fair.
You know, it's a weird, like, I'm a huge Pixies fan, and, like, I love, I know Here Comes Your Man is probably their, like, biggest song of all time, right? Most commercial song. But I never thought of this song as, like, a boy and his father. I would just imagine, like, a dude who's like, I like you to a girl. And,
right, yeah.
And, you know, also it's a really easy song to play on the guitar, so I always played it.
Mm-hmm. Also, I love the Pixies too, but can any movie stop using Where Is My Mind? when something weird happens.
Or any trailer. It. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's the Fight Club was the movie to use it.
That's right.
Like every movie. Yeah. Honestly, also not one of my favorite Pixie songs. Like,
no,
it was one of their, you know, obviously one of their big hits. Or was it? You know, was it just because of Fight Club?
Could be. Yeah.
No, I feel like it was probably, I mean, I like the song, but every time, like when the Pixies comes in my rotation on Spotify, I'm like, where's my mind? Skip.
Yeah, I do the same thing.
But I can't do that with Here Comes Your Man because I just, it's just so you know, so jovial and jaunty. And just,
it's a fun song.
Yeah, such a good song.
Yeah.
Well, Steve, we're not talking about the Pixies again. We're going to be talking about The Simpsons. I think we need to regroup, maybe take some Pixie sticks, up us up, and then just to talk about everything from this episode that we enjoyed or hated or whatever. You know how this works.
Oh, yeah.
So we're going to take a break, and we'll be right back. And we are back. Steve, let's wrap up this week's episode titled Hardly Kirk-Ing. We'll do our usual final bits, which of course is our favorite jokes, favorite jokester, you know, the MVJ's most valuable jokester, our favorite scenes, you know, what we actually thought of the episode in general, give it a ranking, and find out what we're going to watch next week. But before we do that, we love to talk about money, but specifically what from this episode could make money on the good old M word, merchandise. So Steve, what from this episode do you want to see branded on a shirt, a tattoo, or a pregnancy test?
We kind of alluded to it earlier, but those books from the bookstore would be good fodder for enamel pins. I particularly like the drunk uncle one, the uncle with the no good bad day or whatever, and also Paddington versus Corduroy. I think I'd want that on a t-shirt, actually.
Yeah, Paddington versus V Corduroy. Whoever wins, we lose.
That's right.
Yeah, I think that does the choice there. Just any of those books and those book titles as t-shirts, posters. I think it's one of the few occasions where I feel that the writers like took time to like really craft out some really funny puns. And
yeah.
And I appreciate that. It's not like, you know, sometimes we'll watch, you know, they don't have time to make the joke. So like cruising down a street that has this like diner and, you know, music store, and there's nothing punny about it.
Right.
But this was a very fun visual joke. And this one of those, like, hopefully people weren't on their cell phones while this, you know, was going on in the background, because there's some things in this that, again, we say it a lot of times too, when a very visual episode is like, stay off your phones, watch it, because there's joke after joke of visual jokes as well, besides the yuck yucks of voices.
That's right. But I do have to say, in this episode in particular, the yuck yuck of voices is very prominent.
What's your favorite scene or your favorite MVJ or what do you got for that?
So I think that my MVJ, it's a little weird to give it to a performer rather than a character, but, and I'm going to do this probably every time that she's on, but it's going to be Tress McNeil, mostly for her story lady voice, like the choo, yeah, slurp. It's just, I know she's talking to toddlers, but it put a smile on my face just to hear it. Like, she's just always so much fun, and she's so talented that whenever I hear her voice, I just, like, it's fun.
Do you think that's, like, the cynical you is like, I like that because of the how cheesy and like childish like it is as the cynical adult. But as a kid, if you spoke like that to a kid reading a story, they would think it's the funniest thing ever.
That's why I think I like it. You bring up a really good point, because I think I genuinely am enthralled by her. Like, it's not like, look how dumb that is. It's just her as a story lady in a bookstore. She covers it so well that it's everything that I want. So it's, I want to think that it's not actually me being cynical, but I'm actually delighted by her.
Yeah, I think it has to do with like any like childhood or just like childlike performances you see as a kid. They're funny. You know, I've been rewatching Parks and Recreation, and we're towards like the latter half of the series where Andy Dwyer, played by Chris Pratt, becomes Johnny Karate, a kid's performer. Mm-hmm. And as an adult, I'm like, this is the most simplistic thing. Like, why can't I think of that? But it's also very endearing, his character. Like, no, this makes perfect sense. And I think it's just like in nature, as we forget that sort of thing of like, yes, this can be endearing and nice. And I think that's a credit to, like, going back to The Simpsons, to Tress MacNeille and that voice. Yeah. Like, I love it.
Yeah, me too.
And also then her character of the salesperson at the timeshare.
Yeah, the horny condo lady.
Yeah.
Which is also a lot of fun. I love her line about the crocodile.
So was there a favorite line in general, or just we'll give it
to... Oh, boy. I thought Homer was fun. I liked his run of being like thinking he was kind of smart because he was really good at a children's activity.
Is this maybe like a response to like the popular, like maybe like Sherlock, of like the Benedict Cumberbatch?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't know if it was, because like that was kind of popular around this time too.
Mm-hmm.
Just like the noticing of like, or just any like detective show in general, like there's this, there's that. But it's just like, because he's using a kid's hide and seek, or whatever you call it, find the difference pictures. Yeah.
I think so. And also, another line that I really liked is Milhouse's run of, I'm renting a truck. I'm driving a truck. I crashed a truck.
Very good,
I rented another truck. Just really classic stuff.
We should get into it. Was I supposed to say my favorite things too?
What do you like?
I mean, I agree with you, everything there. I think for product wise, I would go with, I love the enamel pins. I want a playset action figure of Milhouse, where you can, like, it's like not a transformer, like more like Lego as transformer, where you could build Milhouse into Kirk. It'd be kind of fun.
That would be a lot of fun. Maybe make it a garage scene with the poison cans.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Also with working a Milhouse hog for peeing.
Mm-hmm.
I think for my favorite jokes, I mean, I feel like this is kind of an episode that, watching it, I knew we're on 188 episodes now. I kind of know what you're going to like, and you kind of know what I'm going to like. I'm like, he's going to like this, he's going to like that. And I think that's the same thing with like the quotes and the jokes that, it's going to be the same. So let's just get into it. What did you really think about this episode, Steve? And why do you want it stricken from the Simpsons canon and never be shown again?
Well, Craig, this episode is awful, and I hated every second of it.
Are you quitting this podcast?
I'm quitting this podcast. I'm done. I'm out.
Bye.
Bye. This is like when Mark Maron interviewed Gallagher. I'm just upset and I'm going to leave. No. This is
you're not. I'm locking the gates and you're not allowed in this garage.
Aw, I wanted to talk to Obama. This is just a silly, goofy episode, and I kind of love it for that. It doesn't try to be smart. I mean, it is smart, but it doesn't try to be like highfalutin. It doesn't even try to be like overly emotionally attached. It's just a fun episode with a dumb premise that works. And that's why I like it. I think it's a must watch. I think that, you know, for this era of The Simpsons, it's just fun to see kids having a good time and exploring with like pretty low stakes. And it's just like, oh, he shaved his head, he's an adult now. It's just a fun episode that doesn't have to be like the biggest of deals. So I just think it's a good time. So I recommend you watching it. You know, I would say that Milhouse has got to be packing at least 8 inches. So of those 8, I'm going to give this a good 7 out of 8 inches of hair that he lost.
Oh.
Yeah. I don't know what you were thinking, Craig.
I was thinking of his pubes.
Oh, okay.
Anything under his pubes.
Yeah.
Penis. Gross. Yeah, I'm going to agree with you on this. It's funny that we will talk about how sometimes when The Simpsons do things that are too cartoony and not realistic, and then we don't like the episode. And this episode is very much that way.
Yeah.
It's so absurd and cartoony, but yet everything just falls into place.
Yeah, there's a good use of kid logic, and it just works.
These young kids of Gammill and Pross, you know, I don't know how old they are. They're probably, you know, early 20s here. Yeah. they know how to work the comedy. And it's amazing, like, we haven't reviewed an episode that they wrote, because there's only a few.
Yeah.
Homer, H-O-M-R, is one of the few, I think, from the later seasons that I remember vividly. And it might be a point of contention between Simpsons fans, but for me, I always liked that episode.
Me too.
And this episode, you can tell, they just do absurd things, but the comedy hits. Everything hits. It's dumb fun. It's one of those episodes. If you just want to watch something that'll just make you smile, it puts a smile on your face. You know, very, very rarely when we review this episode, or when we review episodes, I watch the episode first and then I have to go back, and you do this as well. Mm-hmm. You have to rewatch it for notes, for things, you know, just, you then start reviewing it critically. You watch it for fun and then you watch it for critically and exactly. Then go back over and over again. This is one of the few episodes that I can say that when I was done watching it, I could not wait to watch it again.
Yeah, I completely agree.
Just had a lot of fun with it. I always say this is in the top 10 of the things we reviewed. It might be. Is it a poignant, heartfelt episode? Not at all. It's just joke after joke. Everything lands. I mean, the only weird scene, but still worked.
Yeah.
Was the Ukrainian Kiev puppet show.
Yeah.
Other than that, again, didn't hate it. Mm-mm. That scene, I thought it was great. Definitely a must watch. So dumb. It's so good. That's what it is. And, yeah. You know, these are the guys that know how to kind of write that kind of joke. It's like in the way of that old 70s, almost like Zucker Abrams, you know, Naked Gun Airplane. It's that kind of like school of old school parody writing. And mm-hmm. Very happy with this episode. Definitely recommend. I know going into it last week, like, this sounds dumb. It has the blueprints of being such a shitty episode.
Which is just a credit to the writers to show how difficult it is to write something dumb well. Like, you know, you can write like reference jokes that are like highfalutin, that are smart jokes. And that's actually easier than writing something dumb and having it work on a good level, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's just a fun episode. So if I gave it a ranking, you know, the one scene that I didn't particularly care much about, even though I still think it was fine, was the puppet show with the Modislav Slaughters of 1132. Out of 1132, I'll give this episode a 1138. THX 1138. That's for you, George Lucas. George, are you listening?
Yeah.
Your voice isn't as nasally and nerdy as it usually is.
Sorry.
Oh, there you go. Thanks, George.
I had a googan in my throat.
Was that you trying to do a Jerry Lewis impersonation?
Yeah.
Googan.
Good. I was trying to think of the species that Jar Jar Binks was.
I think it's Gungan.
Gungan, that's what it was. Gungan. There it is. Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm glad we have fun. I feel like we've had a couple episodes that have been stinkers or just that we haven't been enthusiastic about. And this episode brought me back in. And
it's fun when that happens.
Yeah. Well, Steve, let's see if the fun can continue with next week's episode. And to do that, we need the good old Wheel of Random. And if you're listening to the podcast for the first time, the Wheel of Random does assign us episodes at random that we have to review. And here's a caveat, though. We can escape that Wheel of Random if when I pull the wheel and the episode and title number appear, Steve, if he guesses the episode title correctly, we don't have to do it anymore. If he doesn't, we have to continue. But then the real episode title is presented to us. And if Steve then describes the episode correctly, then of course we get to get rid of this Wheel of Random and live our lives. Of course, this never happens because this is a bit.
Yeah.
So, Steve, let's pull that wheel to see what season we're going to be putting our eyes on.
Alrighty, let's give it a spin.
Ba-doop. Season 32.
Season 32.
Should we give that wheel another spin, Steve, to find out what the episode is?
Alrighty, let's give it another spin.
Woohoo! We got episode 6. Season 32, episode 6. Pretty recent.
Yeah, season 32, episode 6. Episode 6. What date did this air?
November 15th, 2020. So just a mere 4 days after your 64th birthday.
That's right. All right, so we've got episode 6. We all know that episode 6 is Return of the Jedi.
And close to two more would be the Devil episode 666.
That's right. So I'm going to say it's Return of the Nedi.
Well, I'd love to hear the pitch for that story, but sadly, that's not this part of the segment. You're wrong, Steve. You are so fucking wrong. It's so fucking disappointing.
Oh, man.
Sorry to be so harsh there.
It's okay. I'm going to go hang myself.
The title is two words.
Okay.
I'll give you a hint. It's your favorite thing to listen to and your favorite thing to watch.
Huh. Pornography?
Close. It's called Podcast News.
Oh, Podcast News.
Yeah. So what do you think this episode is all about?
Well, let's see. There are several podcasts, but so, I mean, it could go a lot of different directions, but we all know that Conan O'Brien was a writer for The Simpsons, and he also made podcasts what they are today. And, you know, he basically invented them.
He invented podcasts.
Yeah. So I'm going to say that Conan starts his own podcast and he has the I Didn't Do It Boy as his first guest. And so he gets Bart, and it's kind of a fun, like, meta episode because, of course, Conan was a writer on The Simpsons. And so he does a guest appearance, and we get Andy Richter, we get Sona, and it's just a fun time. And
Sona Masesium is Conan O'Brien's longtime assistant. Now she's a hit number one New York Times bestseller author.
That's right. So their three are on there.
Matt Gourley? Oh, this is before Matt Gourley was on the podcast.
No, he can do a guest appearance, and then maybe we can have, like, you know, other heavy hitters like, let's say, Mark Maron and Barack Obama and Bruce Springsteen on the show, too.
What about Scott Aukerman? Paul F. Tompkins?
Who?
No. I like your way of going. Sorry, fans, you thought this was true. Just not. But just the quick synopsis of podcast news. Actually, Grandpa is accused of a crime. And then meanwhile, Kent Brockman questions his career. That's from the fandom. That's not a really good description. Let's see what the good old internet movie database. And it says the same thing. Cannot anyone write a good description of the episode? Grandpa is accused of a crime. Kent Brockman questions his career. Okay.
Here's one. Marge and Lisa get addicted to true crime podcasts, and Grandpa is accused of a crime, and so, Kent Brockman questions his career. Okay.
So I'm assuming that they're going to make a couple of Dick's jokes, which was his Yardley Smith's podcast. It was around this. Yeah, she was doing it in 2020.
Yeah, she was.
This aired before. This was pre-COVID, right?
2020. No, this was during.
We're not in lockdown yet, are we?
Wait, this was November of 2020?
Yeah.
Yeah, we went in March of 2020.
Oh, wow. So we're in
We're in the height of it.
Oh, geez.
Time is weird.
Was The Simpsons the only thing that was making new things, I think?
Probably.
Anything animated? Because they probably did it all pre-COVID. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. I was rewatching, you know, all the Fast and Furious movies, probably, because there's nothing else that was coming out this time. All right. Well, see, do you remember this episode? You had to have watched it because it was like the only thing new coming out.
Yeah, I feel like I do remember this episode. I don't remember it very well, but I remember hearing about it. And I feel like there might be some fun guest stars, but I could be wrong.
Maybe just in drawing form only.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay. All right. Well, I'm excited to watch this. It's going to be very current, I think, by all the references, at least. So did I tell you who wrote it?
No.
Should I?
Sure.
Written by David 10 Cohen.
Wow. I haven't even seen David 9 Cohen.
Oh, it might just be David X Cohen.
Oh, yeah.
See, we have a couple of big names as guest appearances or voices. Oh, boy. You got Morgan Fairchild and Stellan Skarsgård.
Champions of the podcast form.
Stellan Skarsgård, I think, showed his dick in Lars von Trier's movie Nymphomaniac.
Wow. It all connects.
All connects to Lars von Trier, who wrote and directed this podcast episode.
That's right. That's why it doesn't make any sense.
All right. Well, you don't need to be like Lars von Trier and show us your genitalia. You can just write to us of your thoughts of this episode or Substance General. And about us, just contact us on social media, 138simpsons at Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
And you can always email us at 138simpsons@gmail.com. And hey, if you're so kind, go to your favorite podcatching app and leave us a review. It doesn't have to be a real review. Just write what your daddy looks like. And leave us 5 stars or the equivalent.
And hey, if you want your daddy to wear some cool clothes, tell him to go to tpublic.com/user/annoyedgrandboys to buy some of our swag. And, you know, tell him also to leave us a voicemail. And that's simple enough to do. You just take your cell phone device, scroll through the show's notes of your podcatching listening device app thing. And there's a little button that says leave a voicemail. You click on that and you say words into your phone. and then we hear it.
That's right. And hey, thanks for listening.
And tell a friend, tell a family.
Mm-hmm. Tell a stranger.
Okay. And now, Steve, I have been Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig for this week.
And for this week, I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve.
And remember, I want you to eat a gallon of ice cream under 2 minutes.
Pretty shapes tell me to kill everybody.
Oh, I could slurp this soup forever. Slurp, slurp.